Thank you to Patreon backers, Fan Major, and Courtney Sleep. Thank you again, guys.
Hello, my fellow attackers, and welcome to a video semi-inspired by Stampy's Could Jonathan Joestar Survive Castlevania video. Star Race Force of Evil is about a 14-year-old human princess from another dimension named Star Butterfly, hanging out with her best friend Marco Diaz as they go on an adventure across the different dimensions and fight enemies wanting to control over immunity or even the multiverse itself. Now, Star is going to go over to Cartoon Network's very own Steven Universe and fight the odds there. The rules for this are as follows. Star happens to use her dimensional scissors to enter Steven's dimension, where she swaps places with Steven and goes through all the arcs he's been through in the series. We'll assume that the gems or any people that help Steven fight the enemies, he's are present, and that Star is in her prime and has a royal magic wand. And now while the gems are present, they can't help her fight. So we'll assume for whatever reason, every single fight, there's a magical barrier that goes up before they can fight. She has the same goals as Steven in SU, minus the pacifist part, and the way she learned things may differ, but she was learning information regardless. Mind you, there might be some different segmenting parts to the story, because there's just some parts that wouldn't make sense narrative wise since Star isn't a gem nor a diamond. So before we can even start, we need to do a mini static central for Star Butterfly herself. Star, as mentioned earlier, is a princess from another dimension. The dimension she resides in is full of magic users, and she's no different. She can use magic in various ways, like unleashing a stampede of warnicorns, creating puppies with laser eyes, blaster rainbows, butterfly nukes, and illusion based jelly beans, and more. Star's magic gets even stronger when she, as the glossary calls it, dips down. This is a state where her cheeks and eyes glow, having her spells become far more powerful. Examples of this includes when she fully broke the glass, keeping Marco in when she couldn't do it with her others, and created her own rainbow giant. Even without the wand, Star is very skilled in hand-to-hand combat, being capable of fighting monsters at the age of 4 and being personally trained by the Knights of Muni. Learn how to break people's necks and swordsmanship. Star is also very intelligent than a lot of people take her for. Despite her acting like an airhead, it's actually revealed in the Book of Magic that she just does it purposefully. She's also shown in Star and Marco's Guide to Dimension to have understand multiverse theory, and also, while she uses magic with the wand, she can also use magic without the wand, entering a huge state known as Golden Muni form, and known as Rainbow Kaiju, which was a form so powerful it could fight the Solarian warrior, well, one Solarian warrior at least, and beat it down. Overall, Star is a cool gal. Now, let's get into this. Alrighty, so the way we're gonna start this is by season to season, so let's start with season one. Star basically has to start with a gem monster all the way in episode one, known as Nephrite, and this is already her first hurdle. While she can take down small Nephrite with no problem, gems in their light form when defeated are poofed. To make sure a gem doesn't come back, the gems put them in a bubble and then put them in the temple. So how can Star get around the regeneration of gems? Well, that part is actually more simple than you think. In season 3 episode 4, Battle for Muni, Toffee, Star in her Golden Muni form does a large blast that hits Toffee. The blast makes Toffee unable to regenerate back, allowing Ludo to kill him. So if gems come back, Star would just likely see the gem monster as like a serpentine and go into Golden Muni and take him out. That or just destroy the gemstone as it's shown to crack easily, as shown when Amethyst cracked hers by falling down a cliff. Though Star isn't out of the loop yet, as the next big enemy she has to deal with is the Red Eye. Now the main problem is, how will Star save Beach City? I'm bringing them mainly to save BC, as Star herself could just easily go to a different place or portal herself out of there, though she needs to do this like Steven and save Beach City. So the situation is, how does she? There's a couple of solutions to this. Firstly, Star has ice magic, allowing her to freeze things like helicopters and leave them frozen in the air, so she could do the same thing to the Red Eye. The second one is mega explosive crystal laser, which is capable of neutralizing an entire planet. Finally, Star has shown portals big enough to suck an entire room in, so she can directly make a portal big enough around the Red Eye to send it to another dimension. Retrieving the Earth Beetle and Heaven Gems would be harder for her, since Pearl and Amethyst need to fuse, but for Golden Muberty, this would be a piece of cake. Hollow Pearl isn't much of a problem either through this, especially since she can't regenerate after defeated, and she's a level 1 combat swordsman, with Star has literal swordsmanship, so easily defeated. This kind of becomes a thing for a lot of Season 1. A lot of these gems aren't really an issue for Star. She's fully equipped with ways to counter. Add on to that, a lot of Steven Universe enemies don't even have outright gem fights, just emotional bonding or world build. For Sea Shrine, I would have to say that Star would likely know not to mess with it any more than she'd already have due to the entire timeline shenanigans that happened inside her wand. However, now it's time for a major roadblock. The first official super enemy of Steven Universe after Red Eye, Lapis Lazuli. Lapis is one of the stronger gems being made to terraform entire planets, and she was unbeatable by even the crystal gems. It took Steven talking it out with her for her to leave. So Star has serious trouble here. However, it's not as bad as you think. Due to Star's large variety of spells, she could
just suck the water that Lapis makes away. And while Lapis has shown being able to make an equal clone with exact gem weapons, those are gems she's imitating. So to say she can imitate a magical wand from another dimension that she's never heard of would be pretty far-fetched, to say the least. Lapis eventually gets defeated, and they both have a talk revealing that Lapis just wants to get home and her gem is damaged, in which Star uses a spell to reform her gem. After a threat like Lapis, the smaller threats can be subdued until Star reaches Jasper and Paradise. However, even she can be stopped. It simply comes down to the fact that Jasper's biggest weakness are insecurities. Remember from Jasper's eyes, Star is just some random inhabitant of a useless planet, so to be even harmed by her and outclassed would make her abandon her views and try to fuse with the nearest person. Besides from Peridot, there's likely no one else that she'd be able to fuse with, which allows Star to venture off in her state of weakness. Thus, Star gets past season one. God, it is such a mouthful for season one, but that's just kind of how long season one is. It's like 50 episodes. Anyways, season two. For finding Peridot, Star is going to handle this differently from gems, as she'd be able to find Peridot far faster due to the all-seeing eye spell. From there, she just needs a portal. Now, unlike most other gems, Peridot is naturally more of a Ludo than a threat, if you get what I mean. So I don't think Star would finish her off, more so get information out of her about the cluster. Also, before anyone asks, Star and Peridot become friends just via hanging around, and Star seeing that she's a pretty cool chick, and they both drill down to where Star defeats the cluster in Peridot's place. Also, Star had no reason to take the sword fighting lessons from Pearl, since she was trained in that as a bab. Season 2 also doesn't have much in terms of fighting aside from the regular gem mods, which Star could easily take care of just fine. So season 2 is just easy. Season 3 immediately starts with the gems fighting Malachite, while Star and Peridot need to deal with their enemy, which research to possibly the biggest roadblock of this challenge, the cluster. The cluster is no joke. It's a fusion composed of millions of gem shards forming a singular entity that Peridot states will grow bigger than the Earth itself. So how will Star stop this thing? Well, remember that spell Star has that can neutralize entire planet? She can easily do that to a cluster, thus stopping this rampage. Thus, Star disposes of the cluster. This is the hardest part of the challenge thus far for Star, so definitely put her at a rest period. Luckily for her, it was also a rest period during Steven Universe. Star talks with Lapis, getting her to join, trying to make Lapis and Peridot besties like she did with Ponyhead and Marco Diaz. Then you have the squad of rubies appear, but you know, Star just kind of blast them away. You also have the return of Jasper, but Star does the same thing she did before. And we also meet Bismuth, who in this continuity has no real reason to fight Star, but let's just say Star in this case heard about the Shattering Plan and is against it, so they fight. Bismuth, while strong, was ultimately defeated by Steven in a fight while he needed to fuse with Connie or Amethyst to even fight Jasper, so Star blasts Bismuth away too. Afterwards, the entire drift into space plot would never happen, because Star easily did away with the rubies on her first encounter, leaving Star just laying down and chilling for season 3. Season 4 was for the most part a rest period for the group, so Star doesn't have much to worry about, and with this time of rest, she can hang out with people growing a better friendship, so hey, good for her. This is when Star investigates Steven's dream about Blue Diamond. She asks Greg to accompany her since he might be helpful to the situation since he's Steven's father. Big mistake there, Star. Anywho, Star and Greg go to the area where Star is ready to attack Blue Diamond. Greg tells her to stay back so he can work his universe charm on them. It doesn't work. Forest Star can go back to the gems to inform them Garnet is already there, and they agree to go save Greg. With this, they head off. Now, little interesting factoid here. The episode that follows is Steven struggling to push a gravity button because he turned off the gravity controls, having the ship move faster and light, which gems light controls forms can't keep up with. Now, I say interesting because for Star, the ship moving this fast would be no problem. Star's best friend Marco can easily dodge multiple laser beams being shot at him, and she can dodge blasts from the wand. Mind you, the wand can reach an entirely different universe in a few seconds, which is stupidly faster than light. So really, if Star did anything stupid like make the ship go faster than light, she'd just push it back to normal without much struggle. Afterwards, the gems inform Star that they need to be careful and not go all attack mode within this base. So they do the same plan as they did in the original show. It all comes down to with Star learning about their plan to colonize more humans from Earth, and then they save Greg, beat down Holly, and go home. Next roadblock is Aquamarine. Her main thing is that she has a wand that causes you to be stuck in place, and Topaz can trap Star by fusing together. Star has real trouble here, as Topaz can just take her wand. Luckily for Star, she has a golden union form that allows her to fly around at fast speed, so she can use her flight to avoid Aquamarine's lasers, and in the process, Topaz has no way of reaching her. Thus, she defeats them both. Now, due to her defeating Aquamarine and Topaz, she never really has any of these space adventures because, quite simply, she wasn't kidnapped, thus ending season 4 for her. I swear so much of the beginning of season 5 is just a rest period. To quickly go through it, Though Star, after dipping down, learns from Pearl that Rose Quartz this entire time was Pink Diamond. Everyone breaks apart, and then basically the same events happen. Star follows Ruby with her, revealing to Ruby that she could just marry Sapphire, and to which she does. The wedding starts, and as the wedding ends, the diamonds attack. This right here is Star's next major roadblock, though. The diamonds are considered to be by far the most powerful gems in existence. So greatly superior to others that even the thought of a diamond getting poofed is considered laughable. So what does Star do? She goes Rainbow Kaiju mode, of course. This form was used to be a Solarian warrior. The same warriors that were so powerful, Eclipsa needed to use her strongest spell to defeat one of them. Mind you, that she's considered the strongest magic user, so her strongest spell would be above stuff like Sky Wing, destroying a universe. So Star goes Rainbow Kaiju mode, fights the diamonds off, and then realizes they're only attacking because they think Pink Diamond is dead. So she reveals to them that Pink is alive and Steven. They go to Homeworld, in which the same events take place. Star is put in jail after trying to go against the customs of Homeworld and eventually reaching White Diamond's place. White Diamond is the final boss for the original series Steven Universe, and Star does the same thing she did to the diamonds and goes Rainbow Kaiju, defeating White Diamond. But White Diamond is taken out. Everyone has their big sing-along as everything is okay in the world. So I put movie and future into the same category, because come on, what exactly is going to happen to Star in the movie? Spinel's main weapon literally only works on gems, and the main weakness that was the driving plot for Steven was the fact that his gem got weaker. Star has three sets of magic to take her down in their first encounter easily, and easily dispose of the gem injector. Future is where the real final boss is, Monster Steven. Which Star just Rainbow Kaijus. It got old after White. See, even with Monster Steven being incredibly much stronger than White, who's stronger than Yellow and Blue, he still doesn't match how strong Rainbow Kaiju is. Yeah. So that ends movie and future and ends the thing. Overall, we've reached a conclusion. Yes, Star would survive Steven Universe and rather easily. Very few hurdles would be a real threat to her, and it kind of makes sense. Star vs. Force of Evil is a journey through the multiverse, fighting people that threaten it. So while Steven Universe is a regular adventure that goes as far as space, but nowhere further. So tell me what you think about this video. If you like it, then maybe we can see if Star can survive Gravity Falls, Owl House, maybe Steven Universe in those scenarios. The sky's the limit with these ideas, but anyways, if you like this video, attack the subscribe button, attack that like button, support me on Patreon, follow me on Twitch, Twitter, Instagram, watch some of my older videos. I am Dat, and I've given you my attack.